Welcome to Airchecks. Guy Lombardo is best known for his New Year's Eve extravaganzas from the Roosevelt Hotel and later the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in New York City. Lombardo started his band the Royal Canadians in 1924 with his brothers and a handful of local musicians from his hometown in London, Ontario, Canada. Guy Lombardo soon became known as Mr. New Year's Eve as Americans rang in 47 New Year's with the Royal Canadians broadcasts from 1929 until 1976. These broadcasts first on radio and then on television were a mainstay of Americans' New Year's psyche as the group popularized the traditional Scottish New Year's tune Auld Lang Syne. The Royal Canadians and Guy Lombardo's version of this song is still played at NYC Times Square at the stroke of midnight on New Year's Eve to this day. Here is the New Year's Eve broadcast from AFRS from December 31, 1945.
Well, gang, this is it, the biggest dancing night in America. We're ringing out the old and swinging in the new, and this is Harry James with all the music makers about to give you the first downbeat on the Armed Forces Radio Service New Year's Dancing Party. All of your favorite bands are on the line tonight to play New Year's greetings from Times Square to Nob Hill. And now from good old Hollywood, we uncork your first noise maker. It's Sad Sack. First round, and this is Harry James adding New Year's greetings as we move right along. And your AFRS dancing party takes the count.
Thanks, Harry. This is Count Basie. And we're coming off of New York City. We're going to make New Year really jump. That's right. It's a 1 o'clock jump.
Thank you.
Basically hoping the new year keeps right on jumping. And you swing around the clock, jump out to California, up Bookshop Boulevard, and to the Covenant Grove.
Thanks, Count Basie. This is Freddie Martin. New Year's Eve greetings from the Grove Gang, the Coconut Grove of the Los Angeles Ambassador Hotel. Wherever this AFRS swing around the clock finds you, we'd like you to join in with your noisemakers as we add our greetings to the music of the Warsaw Concerto.
Thank you. Freddie Martin again, fellas. Thanks for inviting us to the party. And now hang on for a quick switch from the Coconut Grove to the Meadowbrook.
Thanks, California. This is New Jersey. And here comes that wood chopping chap, Woody Herman, with three of the jump in his minutes of 1945, 46, or any year. The wood chopper's ball.
Thank you.
sir. Now from the heart of Hollywood, the Armed Forces Radio Service New Year's Dancing Party swings up the coast to the Golden Gate.
Thanks, Gene Krupa. And greetings, gang, from San Francisco. Henry King playing in the new year from Hotel Mark Hospital. And here's a tune we're sending around the world from Peacock Court.
Swing Around the Clock swings along toward 1946. Our AFRS beam leaves Knob Hill, sweeps down Market Street across the nation, and picks up old Manhattan.
This is the Club Zanzibar in New York, fellas, talking right at you from 49th and Broadway. And we join the AFRS program by bringing you Louis Armstrong and his orchestra.
There's a saxophone boy is getting ready to beat out this new year with Accentuate the Positive. Look out, boy. you heard what Brother Mercer said? Now, have you?
No, neither.
Well, get a load of this now. I'm going to lay it on you.
You got the accent. But you wear the positive limb. Funny to negative. Latch on to the affirmative. But don't mess with Mr. In Between. You got the spread of joy to the maximum. Bring gloom down to the minimum. Have faith. A pandemonium, a lover to walk up on the scene. To illustrate my last remark, journaling way door and door. What did that do when everything seemed so dark? Man, you said you got the accent, but you weigh the positive evening. Mine is your negative. Well, latch on to the affirmative, but don't mess with the in-between, yeah. Latch on to the affirmative, but don't mess with this in between. You got the spread joy to the maximum, bring a little glue down to the air. Have faith, pandemonium, a lively walk up on the scene. To illustrate my last remark, turning away the window. What did they do, choking, when everything seems so dark? Every job.
By Louis Armstrong and his orchestra from the Club Zanzibar in New York City. And now from 49th and Broadway, we take you straight to the shores of the Blue Pacific to Ocean Park, California.
This is the Casino Gardens cutting in with music by Jimmy Dorsey and his orchestra. And now here is Jimmy Dorsey.
Happy New Year, gang. This is Jimmy Dorsey. Let's keep things moving with I Got Rhythm. Thank you.
Dorsey as we leave Ocean Park, California, in the first half of your New Year's dancing party, sent around the world from all around America. After a brief pause for station identification, Les Brown takes over from New York. This is the Armed Forces Radio Service.
Manhattan moves in now as your AFRS New Year's dancing party swings into the home stretch and picks up that band of renown, Les Brown from the Hotel Pennsylvania, 34th Street and 7th Avenue, New York City. Now here's Les playing his famous Twilight Time. From the Pennsylvania in New York gives way now to a cross-country jump to California.
Hiya, gang. Artie Shaw climbing on your 1946 celebration from Hollywood. Okay, Americans, let's dance. Here's a hunk of little jazz featuring little jazz himself, Roy Eldridge. Thank you.
Marty Shaw adds New Year's greetings and sends the AFRS microphone to the Panther Room, the jungle of jive of the Sherman Hotel in Chicago.
The Windy City is doing a couple of loops tonight as we jump out the old and rock in the new with the artistry and rhythm of Stan Kenton and his orchestra. And that means June Christie, the Glee Club, and the Kenton Band in music like Tampico.
You buy a beautiful shawl, a souvenir for Aunt Flo, authentic Mexican art, made in Idaho.
I, Tampico, Tampico, on the Gulf of Mexico, Tampico, Tampico, down in Mexico.
The senoritas, they wave when you arrive at the dock. The native costumes they wear are slacks and bobby socks.
I, Tampico, Tampico, on the Gulf of Mexico, Tampico, Tampico, down in Mexico.
You buy some pottery there, you beat the luxury tax. You find that when you get home, they sell it cheaper at Saks.
I, Tampico, Tampico, on the Gulf of Mexico, Tampico, Tampico, down in Mexico.
From Tampico to San Diego. Grab on there, Pacific Square.
Okay, Chicago, we got it. Tommy Dorsey adds California greetings to this worldwide shindig as we ship out an airmail special to all the APOs and FPOs with TD on that trombone in Song of India.
Thank you.
was Tommy Dorsey wishing you the best for 1946 and tossing the AFRS mic to the poet of the piano.
Thanks, T.D. This is Carmen Cavallaro. We've set up that AFRS mic and Ciro's on Hollywood Sunset Strip so we can add our top request of the night to this king-size dancing party. Here's the Polonaise. Drop in on the party and adding our New Year's greeting to those about to come your way from Salt Lake City.
You've got a New Year's rendezvous in Salt Lake with the man who plays pretty for the people, Louis Prima. Yes, sir, greetings from Louis Prima and Robin Hood.
Another was Alan Neal, 140 more. Together they hit the trail. They would scamper through the forest to the Blue Boar Inn. Mr. Edom told them where they should begin. He took from the rich man, gave it to the poor man. Had a fear for no man, only for his chicken. His name was Marianne. And here was the switcheroo, a Robin Hood's loyal crew. King Richard forgave them all, and here's what they had to do. They became his royal rangers and were very good. So that ends our little tale of Robin Hood.
New Year's greetings and the solid beat of Benny Goodman. And now from down east to the heart of America, we take you to Evansville, Indiana, and Duke Ellington.
It's music by Duke Ellington and his famous orchestra. Here's a title to intrigue you. Let the Zoomers Droop. You know what a Zoomer is? Well, the Duke tells me a Zoomer is a chronic moocher, you know. Got a cigarette pop? Here now is Let the Zoomers Drool.
Final greetings in the modern American music of Duke Ellington from the very heart of America, swinging in the new year and ending your AFRS dancing party. We've been swinging round the clock and sending New Year's greetings around the world from all around America. And here's a big P.S. Yes, sir. Happy New Year, gang. This is Guy Lombardo adding the musical postscript to your Swing Around the Clock as we grab on from the grill room of the Hotel Roosevelt in New York City with the Royal Canadian sentiment for every day of the new year. Speaking for all the bands who have joined hands in sending New Year's greetings around the world from all around America. This is the Armed Forces Radio Service.
That was the New Year's Eve broadcast from AFRS from December 31, 1945. Henry Morgan was an American humorist. He is remembered best in two modern media, radio, on which he first became familiar as a barbed but often self-deprecating satirist, and on television, where he was a regular and cantankerous panelist for the game show I've Got a Secret. Here is the Harry Morgan Show's New Year's Eve show on December 30, 1949.
Show. Yes, the Henry Morgan Show with Arnold Stang, Fran Warren, Kurt Kelton, Milton Kadem's orchestra, me, Ben Grauer, and our surprise guest tonight, Mr. Drew Pearson of Washington, D.C. And here's the star of the Henry Morgan Show standing on his favorite corner in front of the cigar store.
Good evening, anybody. Here's Morgan.
Thank you. Well, now it's the end of 1949, and it's time to clean house before the new year starts. For instance, lying around my apartment, I noticed a big pile of leftover 1949 jokes. You see how it is. You know, we have a lot of programs to do, and the jokes pile up, and we don't get enough programs to get... So I'd like to get rid of them now. Both of us agree that these jokes have to go. Me and the Department of Sanitation. So, if you don't mind, here's a couple of jokes left over from last summer. One. Boy, it's hot. A friend of mine got so sunburned, his wife was able to fry an egg on his shoulder. But it's okay. She's been eating off him for years. Two. It was so hot last night, I went up on the roof for some air. In fact, it was so hot, the television aerials were melting burl all over me. That's a leftover laugh that was supposed to follow the joke. If I'd used that joke last summer, I wouldn't be stuck with it now. Oh, here's a joke we had left over about Stromboli. It goes like this. I understand that Ingrid Bergman... Ingrid... I didn't have it left over. They cut it. Then there was the time last year when I almost went out to California, so I have a California joke here, too. It was left. It says, one smudge pot says to another smudge pot, the smog is so heavy, I can't see Anaheim, Azusa, and Cucamonga. And the second smudge pot says, oh, so's your La Brea tar pits. Now, I got to explain that. You see, you don't think it's funny, but you are not a California studio audience. No, you're not. You aren't even a New York studio audience. Well, that joke's a leftover, and of course, leftovers don't always keep. Oh, here's a joke I had left lying around the house. President Coolidge says, I do not choose to run, but his vice president, Dawes. You see, Dawes was Coolidge's... Well, my house was very dirty. It had a lot of things. Well, you'll have to excuse me, because here comes my friend Gerard. Hello, Gerard.
Hiya.
Well, Gerard, here it is, December the 30th, and tomorrow's the 31st. And on Sunday, we start a brand new year.
Big news.
Yeah, well, maybe you know. You're going to celebrate New Year's Eve, aren't you?
I went out last year, and that's enough.
Why? What happened?
Well, me and Alfred, we went out with a couple of girls.
Uh-huh. Who were they?
Well, I was with Alfred's sister.
Yeah?
And Alfred was with my aunt.
So?
So already the evening was a failure.
Well, where'd you go?
We went to the Fun and Frolic Club.
Fun and Frolic Club. I never heard of it. Where is it?
Well, let's see now. You know Harry's Grab a Bite open all-night cafeteria on 38th Street?
Yeah.
On New Year's Eve, it's the Fun and Frolic Club.
I didn't know that.
$3, a complete dinner, all you can carry on one tray, plus favors.
Favors?
A balloon.
Pretty elegant.
Wait. We get there, and Harry holds the door open. And then he puts his hand out. He was waiting for a tip.
Yeah, yeah.
That was a year ago. He's still waiting. Then Harry takes us to a table. So we sit down, and he stands there and holds his hand out.
So?
So I shook hands.
Well, he expected a tip for showing you a table.
I know a table when I see one. Finally, we get a pastrami sandwich and coffee.
A sandwich and coffee? Is that all you get for $3?
And a balloon.
Oh.
So we're eating, and Harry comes over, and on his harmonica, he starts playing Old Man Moses Dead.
For what for?
Dinner music. So he gets finished, and he holds out his hand.
And?
I give him back his rotten sandwich. And then the show starts.
Show.
Yeah. First, they have a girl tap dancer.
She any good?
I don't know. I didn't see her.
Why didn't you see her?
Harry stands right in front of my table.
Well, that's because you didn't tip him.
Well, I told Harry I'd take care of him later, so he went away.
Mm-hmm. Then?
Next, a guy comes out with a cane and a straw hat.
Oh, who was he?
He was the guy who made my pastrami sandwich.
What'd he do in the show?
He was a tap dancer.
Any good?
Tap dance like he makes a pastrami sandwich. Then they had two more tap dances, and the next act was three girls in bathing suits carrying American flags.
Oh, what'd they do?
Two of them tap danced.
Yeah, and the third one?
She took two flags, held a balloon in her teeth, got on top of the piano,
and
she tap danced. After that, we paid our $12 and left.
Yeah, but before you left, you tipped Harry.
Fat chance.
Oh, but Gerard, you told him you'd take care of him.
Well, the next day, I got three friends of mine. We met Harry in back of the cafeteria and took good care of him.
Friends of mine. See you around, Gerard, and Happy New Year.
Yeah, likewise.
Well, better get over to the broadcast. They need to... Hey, taxi! Taxi! Oh, it's you, the lady cab driver.
So what's the matter? You want to live forever?
Well, hey, tell me something. How were you ever able to pass a driver's test?
I cheated.
Well, how do you cheat on a driver's test?
I copied from the cab in front of me.
Oh, well.
Boy, New Year's Eve's going to be murder. Mm-hmm. Last year, I took the cab out and started cruising, and the cops stopped me.
Why? There's nothing wrong with cruising.
In the Hudson River?
Oh, well, no wonder. You know, we may have to drink that water someday.
Hey, how about the water shortage? Are you cutting down?
Well, I only use the hot water. You see, the shortage is on the cold water.
it's a good thing I don't need water for this cab.
What do you put in your radiator?
Who puts?
Oh, fine. How would you like a crack in your pump?
Yeah, how'd you like a pace in the mouth? Hey, Mac, you mind if I open my window?
The window? No, go ahead.
You do mind?
No.
Tell me if you mind.
Oh, I will.
Might get too drafty back there.
No, it's all right.
I don't want you should catch cold.
I won't.
Too strong, you don't look anyway.
All right, close the window.
You don't want the air?
No.
Maybe that's why you look so pasty.
Well, okay, open the window.
Well, which is it, Mac? Open it or close it?
I don't care.
Open it, you don't care, or close it, you don't care?
Open it, close it, break it. Just hurry, would you please?
Okay, but if you want a cab New Year's Eve, look for me. I'll be the one with no lights.
No lights?
I ain't the only one who'll be driving blind. Come on, you broken-down Sunday drivers. Get those brakes on.
Good evening, anybody. Our vocal star, Fran Warren's going to sing, for free, a tune that would cost you a nickel to hear in a jukebox. This is Where Love Walks Out.
I've seen you through your troubles, when troubles had you down. I've shared the happy moments that seldom came around. I've lived a bit, I've loved a lot. I guess I know the score. But I've got great big news for me. You don't need me anymore. For this is where love walks in, brother. I know what love's about. This is where I came in, brother. So this is where love walks out. My heart's not made of tin, brother, and you're too much for me. I know I just can't win, brother, so I'm through with misery. You gave me one routine too many, I begin to doubt you. And though my little world would be a lonely place to face without you, when love walks in, brother, and doesn't it seem strange that after all you've been, brother, my heart will never change? But this is where love walks
Fran Warren. Hey, Ben,
yeah.
you know what we should try to increase on this program?
The budget?
You're dreaming, Ben. But what we should have more of is world news as reported by the kind of commentator that people hear on Sunday night. Would you introduce me, Ben?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Once again, the makers of Madam Hats for Men bring you Drew Morgan. Men, with winter winds blowing, you might like the new Madam Windproofer, the hat that's guaranteed not to blow off. What keeps it on your head? Thumbtacks. And now, here is the man whose predictions have proved 100% right 14% of the time. Presenting Drew Morgan.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
New York City, New York. 6 months ago, this reporter told you that a certain mayor of this city would be getting married. Well, listen next week for the name of this man. Washington, exclusive. The Justice Department is about to crack down on a congressman who has been passing counterfeit $5 bills. This reporter can now tell you that the name of the man on the $5 bill is Abraham Lincoln. The United Nations exclusive. The big question of the week is recognition of China. Who will recognize China first? The man who is really in a position to recognize China is Chiang Kai-shek. After all, he was born there. And now, a word from Madam Hatz.
Hey, honey, how about a date tonight?
Sorry, George.
Ah, too bad, George. Maybe you'd do better in a hat.
Yes, George, maybe you'd do better in a hat.
So he took her to the Brown Derby. And now, back to the man whose predictions have proved 94% right 18% of the time. Drew Morgan with predictions of things to come.
My first prediction. For the past few months, the malted milk lobby in Washington has become increasingly more powerful. So here's my prediction. Look for a big shakeup. Prediction number 86. As far as this reporter knows, the name of the mystery melody is the National Anthem of England. If I'm not mistaken, a clue to the title is La-Di-Da-Da the King. Prediction number 11. A number of governments are sending delegates to the president to get loans. So I predict that President Truman will be spending more time at his home in Independence, Missouri. Prediction number 49. Next week, the president sends his regular message to Congress. So here is my prediction. The message will read, please wake me at 7:30 tomorrow. I also predict that Congress will continue to fight the president. I further predict that President Truman will be spending more time at his home in Independence, Missouri. Prediction number 2. Margaret Truman is now rehearsing and exercising her voice constantly at the White House. Therefore, I predict that President Truman will be spending more time at his home in Independence, Missouri. Now, this is Drew Morgan in Washington saying, the little men of today who become the big men of tomorrow often belittle themselves as big men, belittling the little men who want to become big men. So remember, turn in all your old tin foil. Thank you and good night. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for applauding that thing. I think I have a surprise for you. The next voice you hear will not be an impersonation. I would like to introduce to you the real, honest-to-goodness, Drew Pearson. Mr. Pearson, what did you think of my impersonation?
Well, Henry, they were terrific. And here's one for you. I predict that you're going to be 100% funny 12% of the time.
Thank you.
I further predict that after tonight, your program will move to Sunday night at 6:30, beginning January 15, 1950.
True, true.
But I'm a little bit afraid, Henry, that you had one of your predictions wrong. I think you were a little too optimistic about Harry Truman, for I predict that after November 1952, Harry will be spending more time in Washington.
We'll see.
However, the real reason I'm here is not to correct your swell predictions, Henry, but to tell the folks what I think is one of the great stories of the Christmas season. There have been a lot of great Christmas stories, from Dickens' Christmas Carol to Heywood Broun's famous column. But this year we have a Christmas story of doing, of veterans who have fought our wars, led by the American Legion, who don't want to fight any more wars and who want to build up friendship abroad. So the Legion is asking every American child who can spare one toy from under his Christmas tree to send it to the nearest Legion post for the kids abroad who haven't had a real Christmas for a long time. The Legion believes that Europe's children of today can be our best friends of tomorrow. So by sending toys or cash to your nearest Legion post, you too can participate in this great Christmas story. And thanks ever so much, Henry Morgan.
Thank you very much, Drew. Milton Kadams and the orchestra will now play a little bit of music arranged by Bernie Green to remind you of what's likely to happen along about midnight tomorrow. There'll be a hot time in the old town.
gentlemen, customs for celebrating New Year's Eve have changed a good deal in the past 2 years. Time was when everybody would go off to big parties or nightclubs to welcome in the new year. But now, many people prefer to spend a quiet evening with friends at home. Here, for example, is a married couple, Henry and Ruth, on the way to spend New Year's Eve with their friends, George and Alice.
Well, why do we have to spend New Year's Eve with them, of all people?
I know how you feel, Henry, but they came over to our house last New Year's, so when they invited us over this year, what could I say?
Well, how about no? I don't want to spend my New Year's Eve with that loudmouth.
I know how you feel.
New Year's Eve, of all time.
I know how you feel.
I know how you feel. I know how you feel. Another thing, when they came to our place last year, did we tell them to bring their own bottle?
Well, no.
And George drank up everything they had in the house? In fact, it's his fault that the radiator in the car broke down.
Why?
Well, don't you remember we ran out of liquor, he went out and drank the antifreeze?
Oh, yeah.
Well, now, how come we have to bring our own bottle?
Well, when it comes to spending money, George is a little tight.
Come to anything, George is a little tight.
Did you buy a bottle?
Yeah, I got it here, quarter rye.
Was it expensive?
89 cents.
89 cents?
Well, it's really 84 cents. You get a nickel back on the bottle.
What kind is it?
Donald Duck.
Henry, that sounds terrible.
Yeah?
Yes.
Well, how come we have to bring our own bottle?
But George will know it's cheap. He's a connoisseur of liquor.
Liquor, no. Antifreeze, maybe, but liquor, no.
We're here. Now, please, Henry, try to act nice and don't get drunk like you did last year.
Drunk? Who got drunk?
You. I suppose you don't remember when George shouted, "Ring out the old, ring in the new," and you tried to wring his neck.
I remember, and I was cold sober.
Please, this time try to be pleasant.
Well, how come we have to bring our own bottle? Okay.
George, it's Henry and Ruth.
What is?
We invited them over, remember?
We did?
Sure.
I must have been drunk.
Well?
All that Henry eats so cheap, he wouldn't give a something or other to a something man. I forget how it goes. It's a very well-known expression. Let me see. He's so cheap that he wouldn't...
Answer the door.
Hey, that chandelier used to be on the ceiling. How come it's on the wall?
It isn't. You're on the floor.
Oh, yeah. Happy New Year!
Stop that. You get up and answer the door.
Okay. Door. Door. Point me to it.
Oh, never mind. Oh, oh, darling, how nice of you to come. Oh, you look wonderful. Well, Happy New Year.
Same to you.
Hello, George.
Hello, Henry.
How are you, George? So I can see.
Well, Henry, I bought a little drink.
Okay. Here, George, I brought you a bottle of liquor.
Oh, Henry, you shouldn't have done it.
I know.
Donald Duck, eh? Never heard of it.
Oh, it's great stuff. I drink it all the time. You'll love it.
No, I'm drinking imported scotch. But if you like the stuff, I'll serve it to you.
Oh, well, I don't mind.
No, Henry, I insist. I'll go get some soda. I'll be right back.
George is a little high. He started drinking early to celebrate the holiday, you know.
Which holiday? Lincoln's birthday?
What do you think about this water shortage? Isn't it awful?
Terrible. We're doing everything we can to conserve. George is simply wonderful about it.
I'll bet.
What is that here, folks? Let's drink. Here you are, Ruth. Scotch. Alice. Champagne. Here you are, Henry. Donald Duck.
Nice.
Come on, everybody. Let's be merry. Alice, give me a shoe.
Why?
I'm going to drink a toast out of your shoe. That's the ticket.
George.
Now, we're just filling up the old champagne there. Now, a toast to 1950. May it be full of prosperity and something. Hey, who stole my drink? I just filled your shoe with champagne and it's empty.
I've been trying to tell you, I'm wearing open-toed shoes.
Oh, well, I'll drink it out of my shoe. Henry, aren't you going to drink your drink?
Oh, yeah. Sure.
That's the spirit. Oh. Let me make it a little stronger.
No, thanks, George. Really, we have to be going.
Going? But you can't go yet. You have to wait till midnight and see in the new year.
Yeah, sing Auld Lang Syne and stuff. Won't that be fun?
Yeah.
Sure, have another drink. I'll go in the kitchen and get some more soap.
George certainly gets into the spirit.
And vice versa.
Yeah. Hey, look at that fun in the kitchen. A can of spaghetti. Happy New Year, everybody.
Whee! George, you're not supposed to throw spaghetti. Confetti.
Ah, who cares? Let's celebrate. What's the matter, Henry? Why don't you drink a drink?
A meatball fell in it.
Shh. Listen, everybody.
6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
Ralph, good night.
Did you really run so soon?
We really must. We're very tired.
Yeah. I had a miserable day. I had a very hard day. Very hard.
Well, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, Alice.
Happy New Year, George. Same to you.
Shall all acquaintance be forgotten?
You said it.
Well, next New Year's Eve, you folks must come to our place. Right, Henry?
Yeah.
We'd love to. Right, George?
Shall all acquaintance
should old acquaintance be forgotten?
Yeah, next year at our house. Oh, well, listen, after all, we got a whole year.
Should old acquaintance be forgotten, never lost.
Oh, I'm sorry. The calliope goes first, doesn't it? Oh, he's probably drunk from the sketch or something. Morgan will not be back on the same quadrant from the cigar store at this time. What? At the same time next week. He'll be back all right, not on Friday, though, but every Sunday night at 6:30 Eastern Standard Time, beginning not next Sunday or the Sunday after that, but beginning Sunday, January the 15th. This is true. Morgan will be back on the same corner in front of the cigar store on Sunday, January the 15th at 6:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And in case you're tired of chasing the show around from Sunday to Wednesday to Friday, NBC has promised I can stay there. From January the 15th on, the Henry Morgan Show every Sunday night for years, maybe. Now we get a week's vacation. See you Sunday, everybody, beginning January the 15th. And by the way, Happy New Year and good night. The Henry Morgan Show with Arnold Stang, Fran Warren, Fred Kelton, Art Carney, Gay Seabrook, Milton Cadams and his orchestra, and produced by Kenneth McGregor. And just because Henry Morgan's moving to Sunday nights, don't think that Friday nights on NBC are going to be the least bit dull. Because NBC has a big batch of great new shows for you Friday listeners starting next week. Ronald Coleman and his charming wife, Benita Hume, take over the half hour between 8 and 8:30 with a sensational show called Halls of Ivy. Following the Colemans comes We the People, of course. Then at 9 o'clock, you'll hear the Screen Directors Playhouse, which next Friday stars Jimmy Stewart in a play called Magic Town. And if that weren't enough, at 9:30 comes the famous Jimmy Durante Show, topping it off at 10, The Life of Riley with William Bendix. If that won't make you stay home and listen Friday nights, you just ain't got a radio, mister.
That was the Harry Morgan Show's New Year's Eve show on December 30th, 1949. The Jell-O program starring Jack Benny. January 1st, 1939. Rednet. Sponsored by Jell-O. Jack blows his line 6 minutes into the program and stops the show. Mary reads a New Year's poem. The show features the first performance of The New Tenant, which was to become an annual New Year's fantasy. The Jack Benny program was first broadcast on the Blue Network on 2nd of May 1932. With his capable cast of supporting players, Benny made his show into one of great radio comedy shows. What was so special about this Golden Age classic is Benny's ability to come across as a likable guy despite being vain, argumentative, and a skinflint. People related to Benny, and his willingness to often give the best comedy lines in the show to his supporting cast made him popular with listeners, guests, and colleagues. This is classic comedy that is still funny 60 years later. Here's Jack Benny's Goodbye 1938 Hello 1939 as broadcasted on January 1, 1939.
J-E-L-L!
The Jell-O program, starring Jack Benny with Mary Livingston, Phil Harris, Kenny Baker, and yours truly, Don Wilson. The orchestra opens the program with No Wonder. Well, here we are at the beginning of another year, and Jell-O wants to send greetings to all of you. And we've received a letter that makes a swell New Year's greeting for us. It's from a woman who's been using Jell-O year in and year out for the past 37 years. She is Mrs. C.C. Brown of Huntington, West Virginia. And listen to what she writes. We bought our first package of Jell-O in December 1902. We lived in the country then and made few trips to a store, so the Jell-O was a bit of a luxury, saved for the holiday gathering of kin and friends. Needless to say, Jell-O made a hit, and we've used it exclusively ever since. When I had my own home, I wanted something special. Nothing so filled the requirements as Jell-O. In all those 37 years of use, I've never had a package that wasn't perfect, and Jell-O is a prime favorite with my family. Well, thank you, Mrs. Brown. That's a grand letter to start us off on 1939, and to the rest of you, we'd like to say, if you want to give your family their prime favorite dessert, if you want to enjoy that delicious, extra-rich fruit flavor, look for the big red letters on the box. They spell Jell-O. And now, ladies and gentlemen, this being the first day of the new year, it behooves me to introduce the star of this program in a manner befitting his dignity and position.
Well.
He is a man whose illustrious character and many fine qualities have my sincere admiration.
Oh, Don, please.
A man whose lovable nature and unselfish devotion to others...
Say, Jack.
Quiet, Mary. I want to hear this. Go ahead, Don.
Whose unselfish devotion to others has endeared him to the hearts of his public.
How true.
So I bring you none other than that sparkling, scintillating, outstanding personality...
That's not me. I'll kill myself.
Jack Benny.
Thank you. Thank you. Hello again. This is Jack Benny talking, one of the sweetest guys I've ever met. And Don, I want to thank you for that beautiful introduction. You know, as a rule, a man has to be dead before he gets such a lovely tribute.
Well, I wrote it just before the broadcast while you were lying down.
Oh, you didn't expect me to get up, eh? Well, I am pretty tired after last night. Hey, by the way, Don, what did you do New Year's Eve? Did you have any fun?
Oh, I had a swell time, Jack. Simply wonderful.
That's good.
First, I took my wife to a movie, and then we went to the Coconut Grove to celebrate.
Well, that was nice. First a picture, and then the Coconut Grove. I suppose you danced a lot.
No, my wife left her shoes in the movies.
Well, there's nothing like relaxing at the cinema. I often slip my shoes off myself, but I'm getting so absent-minded, I'm not going to do it anymore.
You're not?
No. The other night at Grauman's Chinese, I was clear down to my underwear before the usher stopped me. Oh, it was embarrassing.
I can imagine. Well, tell me, Jack, how did you spend New Year's Eve? Any excitement last night?
Well, I had a fairly good time, Don. I took Mary to the Wilshire Bowl, you know, where Phil Harris is playing.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. Say, you had a pretty good time in my place last night, didn't you, Jackson?
Yes, I had a nice time, Philson. But as long as it was your place, you might have seen that I got a decent table.
What are you talking about? Your table wasn't so far away.
It wasn't. I was so far from the bandstand, I couldn't even see the circles under your eyes. As a fine table.
Oh, you're exaggerating, Jack. There were a lot of people sitting behind you.
Listen, Phil, the only people sitting behind me were from Pasadena, and they were home at the time. What a New Year's Eve.
Well, Jack, maybe Phil couldn't help it. New Year's Eve's a big night, and after all, first come, first serve.
That's what burns me up, Don. I was the first one in the place. I got there so early, the manager asked me to help blow up the balloons. How do you like that?
Well, you got paid for it, didn't you?
That's not the point. Now, let me tell you another thing, Phil. I don't mind my table being far away, but the next time you seat me behind a post, please see that there's a knot hole in it.
Behind a post? What are you talking about?
Oh, never mind.
Hello, Jack. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. I was just telling Phil about the fine table he gave us last night. Imagine seating us behind a post. It burns me up.
You're crazy, Jack. We weren't behind a post.
We weren't?
No, that was a piece of confetti on your glasses.
Well, why didn't you tell me? I nearly broke my neck trying to peek around it. Anyway, post or no post, we were certainly sitting far enough away from everything.
Well, I'm glad we were. I was so ashamed sitting next to you with that old-fashioned tuxedo you had on. Why don't you buy a new one?
Oh, how often do I wear a tuxedo? Besides, it isn't so old.
It isn't?
No.
Go on, I put my hand in your pocket and pulled out a program from Ford's Theater.
Listen, Mary, that suit might be a little out of style, but they're still wearing single... Now, listen, Mary. That suit might be a little out of style, but they're still wearing single-breasted tuxedos.
Not with a belt in the back.
Well, they're coming back, so don't be so smart.
Mary's right, Jack.
Oh, she is.
Your pants were so tight, you had to wear your garters on the outside.
Listen, Maestro, one more crack out of you, and you'll be leading the organ on the Lum and Abner program. And another thing, Phil, the next time I dance by your orchestra, watch your baton. Remember that.
Okay, buddy.
Buddy. Incidentally, fellas, this being the new year, I was going to give you all a raise in salary, but the way you've been acting today, I'm not going to do it.
I'd be satisfied just to get my regular salary on time.
Now, wait a minute, Phil. Don't give me that. I put your check in the mail every Monday morning.
Well, from now on, don't pin it on a postcard. I don't want people to know what I'm making.
All right, Phil, cut out the beefing. Let's see if we can't inaugurate the new year with a little harmony.
Oh, Jack, you want to hear something awful?
What, Mary?
Here it is, New Year's, and I forgot to write a poem about it.
Oh, that's a shame.
I'll sit right down and dash one off.
Okay, hurry it up.
I'll fill in a little time for you, Mary. Ladies and gentlemen, while Miss Livingston is struggling with her latest brainchild, let me remind you that one of the best ways to start out the new year is to have Jell-O for dessert.
Darn this pen.
It is tempting, delicious, easy to make, and comes in six delicious flavors.
Hey, Jack, how do you spell knowledge with an N or a K?
With a K.
Strawberry, raspberry, cherry.
With a capital K?
Orange.
Yes, a capital K.
Lemon and lime, for heaven's sake.
I'm sorry, Don. And now, folks, going from the...
All right, Jack, I'm all set.
Why, Mary, is your poem finished already?
Yeah.
Gee, you work faster than George Bernard Shaw.
Well, his beard gets in his way.
Oh, that's right. What's the title of your poem?
Goodbye, 1938. Hello, 1939.
Well, that covers everything. Go ahead.
Oh, Happy New Year, Happy New Year. Please don't be a sad and blue year. These last 12 months have been sublime. So goodbye, 38. Hello, 39.
Well, so far, nobody is screaming.
You just wait.
Oh.
I wonder who this coming year will be our favorite movie star.
Hmm.
Will it be Garbo or Sonya Heine? So goodbye, 38. Hello, 39.
90?
What has this year in store for us? For thee and thou and thy and thus. Will Don get fatter? Will Phil be gay? Will Kenny get knowledge with a capital K?
I doubt it.
I'd like to ask you if I dare, will Jack continue to lose his hair?
Mary.
And when it's gone, will it stay away? Goodbye, 38. Hello, toupee.
Mary, get to the last verse, will you?
It's coming up now.
That's good.
Oh, Happy New Year. Happy New Year. Please don't be a sad and blue year. We will give you one more chance. So goodbye, Broadway. Hello, France.
Well. Mary, you finally did it. Hey, Phil, do you think you can follow Mary's poem with a number?
I'll try.
Okay, hit it, boys. Wait a minute. Come in.
Mr. Benny?
Yes?
Oh, Happy New Year. Happy New Year. To the greatest man I know. And I bring you fondest greetings. There's a wagon. I must go.
Well, I'm glad they let him out for our program. Play, Phil. Say It With a Kiss, played by Phil Harris and his original orchestra. And now, ladies and gentlemen...
Original? Yeah. Wait a minute, Jack. This isn't the band I started out with.
I don't mean that, Phil. I mean, when they look at their music, they still play something original. And speaking of the band, Phil, you'd think that they could start out the new year by dressing a little better. Where'd they get those awful-looking neckties?
Aren't they atrocious?
They certainly are. Where'd they get them?
I gave them to them for Christmas.
Oh. And say, and that reminds me, Phil, that was some Christmas present you sent me. You must have been under the weather when you bought it.
Oh, no, I wasn't. I was sober as a judge when I bought your gift.
You were not.
I was, too.
Then let me ask you something. What use have I got for a porthole? Isn't that a fine present, Mary? A porthole.
Well, if your head gets any bigger, you can use it for a monocle.
All right, don't make it any worse than it is. Oh, hello, Kenny.
Hiya, Jack. Happy New Year.
Well, Kenny, I see you're still celebrating. You must have had a good time last night.
I'll say. I didn't get to bed until 10 o'clock. Gosh, I'm a wreck.
Kenny, how can you be a wreck if you went to bed at 10 o'clock?
I slept in a folding bed and I forgot to pull it down.
Well, it's none of my business, Kenny, but would you mind telling me how you got into a folding bed without pulling it down first?
I'm not going to tell till I get it patented.
Oh, that's right. Guard your secret carefully. And stop blowing that horn.
Well, I'm practicing for the Rose Bowl game at Pasadena tomorrow. Say, are you going, Jack?
I certainly am. I wouldn't miss it for anything. Hey, Mary, I got a couple of good seats. You want to go with me?
No. I went with you last year, and you were the only one in the stand wearing a raccoon coat and a beanie.
Well?
And the way you were waving that pennant around, I was so embarrassed.
Well, what's wrong with waving a pennant?
Yours said Waukegan High School on it.
All right, you don't have to go with me. I'll take somebody else. You want to go with me, Kenny?
Sure, but I'll have to bring my girl along.
I don't see how, Kenny. I've only got two seats.
Well, I'll invite her anyway. Maybe we can lose her in the crowd.
Yes, that ought to solve our problem. Incidentally, I mislaid my ticket somewhere in the house. I hope Rochester finds them.
Hey, Jack, who do you pick to win the game, Duke or USC?
Well, Phil, I'm a USC man myself, and I think it's a cinch for them to win.
Oh, you do, eh? Well, how much do you want to bet?
I didn't say anything about betting, Phil. I just told you who was going to win.
Well, if you're so sure about it, why don't you want to bet?
Because gambling is naughty. And you know it.
You mean because you're a scaredy cat.
Scaredy cat? Listen, Harris, what are the odds on the game?
2-1 on USC.
All right, wise guy, I'll bet you 20 cents to a dime, and put up or shut up. Well, what are you stalling for, Harris?
He's afraid if he wins, you'll fire him.
That's it.
I thought you'd welch on it.
20 cents to a dime. Make that $100 to 50 and you got a bet.
Don't try to show off, Phil. You had your chance. Now, let's drop it.
You know, I don't think Jack wanted to bet at all.
Think? Kenny, your job on this program is to sing.
Well, I can have a hobby, can't I?
You better stick to stamps, Kenny, and go ahead with your song so we can get to do our play tonight.
Okay.
Hold it a minute. That must be Rochester. I asked him to call me. Hello?
Hello, Mr. Benny. This is Rochester.
Yeah, I was waiting for your call. Did you find my two tickets for the Rose Bowl game?
No, I looked high and low. I can't find them anywhere.
Doggone it, that's a shame. Well, keep on looking. They might be in the house. They must be in the house someplace.
Okay.
So long.
So long. Say, boss, can I have tomorrow off? I gotta go to a wedding in Pasadena.
A wedding in Pasadena. Tell me, Rochester, who's getting married?
What was that, boss?
I said, who's getting married in Pasadena tomorrow?
Oh, aunt of mine.
An aunt of yours, eh? Who's she marrying?
Some fella that's going to be my uncle.
Uh-huh, I see. Now, at what time does this wedding take place?
They kick off by 1:30.
What's that? What did you say?
Nothing. Keep quiet, operator.
Rochester, there was no operator on the line. Now, you found those Rose Bowl tickets, didn't you?
Well, I...
You found those tickets, didn't you?
Am I under oath?
Answer me. Did you or did you not find those tickets?
Sing, Kenny.
Listen, Rochester, when I get home tonight, I want to find those two tickets on the dresser in my bedroom.
Okay, boss. Happy New Year.
Go ahead and sing, Kenny, that Rochester. The only way I can keep things in my house is to nail him down.
I promise you with heart sincere that I will always love you, dear. That when you need me, I'll be near. I promise you. My love for you is as great as a love can be. Yet words couldn't quite express the way that I feel. And as we stand at the doorway of days to be, I faithfully take an oath on all that concerns us both. I promise you with heart sincere that I will always love you, dear. That when you need me, I'll be near. I promise you. I promise you I'll build a shrine where we can keep our love divine until the very end of time. I promise you. With every dawn that I awaken, I know my chances will increase to keep the vow I've taken, to see that your joys never cease. I promise you your heart will sing in what will seem eternal spring. I'll try to bring you everything I promise you.
That was I Promise You, sung by Kenny Baker. And Kenny, that was very good for a fellow who stayed up until 10 o'clock. Your voice hardly showed it.
Oh, I'll pull myself together in a couple days.
I hope so. And Kenny, if you got to bed at 10 o'clock last night, how'd you get those awful circles under your eyes?
I painted them on. Ain't I nuts?
You sure are. And now, ladies and gentlemen, for our feature attraction this evening...
I was going to paint wrinkles on my forehead, but my mother wouldn't let me.
Well, she was right. And now, ladies and gentlemen...
If I was Kenny's mother, I'd trade him in for an Airedale.
Now, Mary, Kenny's mother wouldn't do that. And now, folks...
We've got an Airedale!
All right. If you two will quiet down, I'd like to get on with our play. And now, folks...
You know something, Kenny? I never met your mother.
Oh, you didn't?
Phil, for heaven's sake, who cares? Now, let's get on with the play. Everybody's butting in here but Don.
Well, I met Mrs. Baker.
Oh. Well, I'm very happy to know it. And now, folks, going from Mrs. Baker to our feature attraction of the evening, this being the first day of the new year, tonight we are going to present an original play, a sort of a New Year's fantasy entitled The New Tenant, or Goodbye 38, Hello 39. Now, I will...
You stole that from my poem.
Mary, that was just a coincidence, believe me. Now, in this fantasy, I will play the part of 1938. And Mary...
You know, Jack, I read this play 4 times, and I still can't understand it.
Well, in the first place, Kenny, our play is a little too deep. And in the second place, you're a little dope. Now, I will be 1938, and Mary will be Mrs. 1938, my loving, loyal wife. And we have 12 children. What are you laughing at?
I don't know. It's censored.
Then keep still. Now, our play opens in the home of Mr. and Mrs. 1938, who live in a big round house called the Earth. It is almost midnight on December 31st, and their lease is about to expire. Curtain. Music. Oh, Mariah.
What do you want, Pa?
Better hurry up with that packing. The landlord says we got to get out by midnight to make room for the new tenant.
The new tenant? Who is he?
Oh, some little nudist by the name of 39. He don't know what he's getting into, does he, Ma?
Nope. This house sure has been a mess, ain't it?
You said it. Remember a couple of months ago when the bathtub ran over and got New England soaking wet?
I sure do. And say, Pa... What about the time last spring when the roof leaked and we had to hang Los Angeles out to dry?
Wasn't that awful?
Yep. Hey, Pa, turn on the moon. I can't see what I'm packing here.
Okay. Hey, moon.
What do you want, you old fossil?
I want some light down here. And quit winking at my wife.
Okay. Say, you want some milk, too?
Milk?
Yeah, a cow just jumped over me.
Well, I'll be darned.
Quit gabbing, Pa. We ain't got much time.
That's right. Darn those shooting stars, they're having a feud again.
Doggone it, Pa. Even with all our troubles, I kind of hate to leave here.
So do I. After all, we did have a lot of fun.
Remember the time that scallywag Howard Hughes flew around our house in 5 1/2 days?
Do I? He sure had me dizzy. And then that fella Corrigan. He started to fly from the kitchen to the parlor, and the darn fool ended up on the back porch.
Say, Pa, did you pack up all the swing music?
I'm doing it now. Flatfoot Fluji with the Floy, Floy. Might as well take that with us. Say, Ma, it's 12:05. We better start rounding up the kids. Where are they?
Well, January, February, and March are outside playing on a cloud.
Oh, where's April?
He's taking a shower.
Oh, he's always doing that.
The rest of them are around here someplace.
Well, tell them to stick close. We're going to leave in just a few minutes.
I wonder who that can be.
I'll go over and see. A tisket, a tasket. Boy, am I sick of that.
Well, well, look who's here.
Who is it, Pa?
It's old man Mars from across the Milky Way. Hiya, Mars.
Hiya, neighbor. Heard you were leaving tonight, so thought I'd drop over and say goodbye.
Well, that was mighty sweet of you.
Say, I sure handed you a scare a couple of months ago, didn't I?
You certainly... Hey, what was the big idea, anyway?
Well, I really didn't mean it. I was lighting a cigarette, and I reached down in the Hudson River to put the match out.
And what happened?
Well, my hand slipped, and I gave New Jersey a hot foot.
You sure did. Say, Mars, you'll have to excuse me now. It's almost midnight, and I gotta be getting out of here. So long.
So long. Oh, say, I got my rocket ship outside. Can I give you a lift anywhere?
No, thanks. We'll be all right. Say, those rocket ships smoke a lot, don't they?
Yeah, the exhaust pipes are bad. I just flew by heaven, and now angels really got dirty faces.
Well, if you pass by the other place, give my regards to Fred Allen. So long, Mars.
So long.
Well, Ma, it's almost midnight, so put on that silly hat of yours and let's get going.
Okay, Pa.
There's the first stroke of 12. I wonder what's keeping the new tenant.
Don't worry, he'll be here.
Doggone, Ma, I forgot to find out where we're moving to.
Thought you bought a place over on Jupiter.
No, but I took a look at Venus. Time's a-fleeting. We can't leave until that little brat gets here.
That must be him now.
Yep. Come in. Well, hello, young fella. Are you the little New Year?
I ain't Bobby Breen.
Well, well, my boy, come right in. Well, this is it, young man. Tell me, what do you think of your new home?
Boy, what a dump. This house could stand a lot of fixing up.
I know it, son. A lot of things wrong here, my boy. Yes, sirree. That Spanish shawl on the piano there is all ripped and torn. Need a lot of mending. And another thing, the china is just about all smashed to pieces. And while I think of it, son, if you see some little lost sheep roaming about, try and find a place for them around a house somewhere.
I'll do what I can. For heaven's sake, let's get going.
Just a second more. Now, there's just one more thing, young fella.
What's that?
May not sound like much, but it's a mighty big issue. Your greatest worry, my boy, is going to be to pick out a Scarlet O'Hara. That had me groggy all year.
Come on, Pa, you're talking too much.
I'm coming, Ma. Say, young fella, if you want any Jell-O, you'll find plenty in the pantry.
Thanks, old-timer.
You're welcome. Happy New Year, young fella.
Happy New Year.
Come on, Ma, let's go.
Here's a swell new dessert for the holiday season. It's one the whole family will enjoy, and it's easy to prepare. It's Jell-O butterscotch pudding. And until you've tried it, you don't know just how delicious a pudding dessert can be. Creamy, smooth, rich, and tasty, with that real old-fashioned butterscotch flavor that will bring the family back for more. Then try the new Jell-O vanilla pudding. Tempting, delicate, and full-flavored. And a Jell-O chocolate pudding, smooth and chocolatey, the kind that Mother used to make, but far quicker and easier. For all three Jell-O puddings take next to no time to prepare. There's only a few minutes cooking required. You'll find the simple directions on every package. And these new puddings will be a real surprise to you, for they're just as good as your own. Made with the same fine, wholesome ingredients, with a taste and texture you'll say is perfect. The best way to buy is to get three packages at a time. So ask your grocer for Jell-O butterscotch, vanilla, and a chocolate pudding. The real homemade kind.
This is the last number of the 14th program in the new Jell-O series. And we will be with you again next Sunday night at the same time. Are you listening, Tommy? And now, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to announce that in response to many, many requests, and owing to a renewed and timely interest, we are going to present our version of Walt Disney's famous picture, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, next Sunday night. So if you missed it the first time, folks, be sure and tune in. And if you heard it, tune in anyway, as we're going to have a brand new Prince Charming. Guess who, folks? Oh, Andy, you gave it away. Good night, folks.
is a courtesy of Marvin Loire Productions.
That was Jack Benny's Goodbye 1938 Hello 1939 as broadcasted on January 1, 1939. The Gene Shepherd Show, War AM, with the original transmission date, December 30, 1964, entitled as The New Year's Eve Raid at the Kansas City Burlesque House. Shep laments living in the 20th century and recalls a childhood New Year's Eve with buddies Bruner, Flick and Schwartz taking in a midnight matinee. Shep then recalls another, more adult, New Year's Eve during 1940s wartime replete with fights, burlesque queens, wall-to-wall vomiting and the Greatest Generation. He refers to war engineer Skip by name a couple times during the show. This is a slightly edited broadcast, with improved audio, to fit within a 30-minute time slot.
Thursday is going to be the last day of the year, and Friday is going to be New Year's Day. Somehow, you're one kind of person on Thursday, and you can magically be another one on Friday. Yes, that illusion has persisted. Oh, they do all kinds of things in the various tribes. You know, one tribe would decide about a month and a half before the old year petered out who the rotten people were who caused that year not to work out. Because none of the years worked out, see? And so they would designate, they would get the medicine man would get out there, and he would get the bones going, and he would start lighting up the incense, and he'd get the fires going, and then he'd start blowing on it, and he would finally determine out of the tribe what 17 people were responsible for that year falling on its face. And then they would get rid of them. They would say, well, we're not going to carry that crowd over into the next year. And next year it's going to work out. And they would have a gigantic ceremonial house cleaning. And you know, that's part of the illusion. Part of the illusion of New Year's is that, boy, what a relief. What a rotten year that we've just finished. And that it's going to be different next time. And of course, next year, by this time, the same guys will be writing. Well, of course, 1965 was a year of troubles. It was a year of pressures on all sides. It was a year of nervousness, a year of decision. However, we feel that 1966, eternally, and all the way back there in the jungle somewhere in the darkness, you can hear the sound of the medicine man. That medicine man that lies deep within each one of us. Doing, 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 doing. That little medicine man that's squinched down there on his haunches next to your pancreas with the fires lighting up. Oh, it's a scary time. It always is. It's a wild moment. New Year's. And there's a lot of things connected with this. I can only say from my own personal experience, and I'm sure that everybody who has lived in 20th century America, America is probably the most age-worried country in the face of the globe. It's so worried about being older than 5 years old, gets frantic. People at 19 already figure it's all over. Oh, the bags under my eyes. Oh, look at me. Oh, I've heard him say it. It's incredible. And so we live in a nation, really, that is frantically trying to stop time on all fronts. And at the same time, paradoxically and nutty enough, it's trying to leap forward in time. We are both at one and the same time hung on stopping time and hung on progress. And to go into the year 2078. And I suppose you get up there and you want to erase that year and go into the year 3049, you know. Do you feel a sense of accomplishment now that 1964 has just about petered out? It is extremely bitter on one side and extremely sweet on another. I feel that personally, having lived in 20th century America, so have you, that this one holiday is one of the most cataclysmic 3 days, personally, in all people's lives that I know around me. In other words, more wild things happen. I don't mean just a party where you fall down the stairs or the night Charlie the Oldsmobile off the bridge, you know, that kind of jazz. That isn't what I'm talking about. I'm saying that more decisions and more actual
turning points are reached in lives during the New Year's holiday than any other holiday or any other specific point in time in the whole calendar. In short, more people are asked to be married on New Year's. More people realize the jig is up on New Year's. More people have looked suddenly back and they say, oh, gee, look at that. It's suddenly 19XDX, and they are reminded that they have not moved an iota, maybe backwards. That's the only time of the year you're really reminded of those things, really. It is a strange and very scary time for people, even kids. It's the only time, really, I think, that kids themselves are reminded that time passes. Now, I remember one New Year's. What is the first New Year's that you can actually remember, the first year that you can remember as coming in? You know, they're celebrating, say, 1942 or something. What is the first year you can remember? I'll tell you, I'll award the brass biglegy with bronze oak leaf palm to the person who can give me the earliest one without phoning it up. No, I'm sure that some guy, somebody, somewhere, must actually be around who remembers 1900 coming in, you know? I mean, who's just listening right now, who really remembers the turn of the century, which would be a fantastic New Year's. Can you imagine when the year 2000 comes in? What a wild New Year's that would be. Boy, because almost every last one of us, you know, around, all we'll ever know will be the 20th century. So we're 20th century men. That's it. And there must be some guy out there who went to bed, it's 1899, and he says, well, tomorrow, can you imagine how difficult it must have been to get to write a new century? It's hard enough to learn to write a new year, and we do that all the time. Once every 100 years, you write a new century in, but 1965 is not far away. I remember one New Year's sitting in a balcony. I was in this balcony with about nine guys, Schwartz, Flick, Bruner, a whole bunch of us. And there was a tradition around there. I don't know whether they do it here in New York or not, but all the movie houses had big New Year's Eve shows, giant New Year's Eve, special shows for New Year's Eve. And you would pay extra or something, and you would come in about 5 or 10 minutes to midnight. The regular shows would stop. This is the movie houses, you see. The regular shows would stop at 11:45, and all the people would file out. Either that or they would pay extra to stay. And at midnight would be the New Year's Eve show. And everyone would sit there in the balcony. They'd all file in. They'd give you horns and jazz. Why everyone went to the movie house to celebrate this, I don't know. But everyone got horns and streamers and all kinds of confetti and stuff, and we all filed in there. So we were sitting there. The reason that it was such a traumatic New Year's Eve, it was the first New Year's Eve I remember spending not at home, not in the bosom of the family with my kid brother asleep under the day bed, the yelling and hollering in the kitchen, and Uncle Fred out there hollering and pouring beer down the sink, and my mother trying to calm everybody down who's been sick and throwing up for an hour and a half, you know. And there was a thing. Well, you know, that's what New Year's was about, I guess. And it was the first time, and you felt vaguely debauched, because the idea of a midnight show somehow had sexual overtones and connotations of debauchery. And they always had these pictures in the paper, and it says, be sure to see the midnight show at the Paramount. And it would show a picture of a girl, you know, a girl with fans or birds all over her and little bubbles all over her head, and she's holding a cocktail glass, and it says, whoopee. And so the nine of us go to this place. A whole bunch of us took Flick's car, and Schwartz and Flick and Bruner and everybody. We're all sitting right on the edge of the balcony in the Paramount Theater. And at exactly midnight, the lights were on. The organ came up, and there's ta 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 ta. You know, they play Auld Lang Syne. Everybody cheers and hollers, and the balloons fly up, and everyone throws the paper stuff out there. And within 8 seconds, nine fights broke out. It was the first time I ever saw fights. You know, the kids don't really sleep. Guys are fighting all of them. Get your hands off my girl. And they're starting to hit some fist fight. Guys are drinking and yelling and hollering. All this was at the local theater where I had grown up sitting next to Tarzan and Jane, where, you know, they didn't do this kind of stuff. And within 5 minutes, the place is in an uproar. The police are running around. They get it all calmed down. And it's now the new year. And they start up with the feature, and it was a double feature of monster movies. Why monster movies play an important part on New Year's Eve, I don't know. But this was a big deal in Chicago, that whole area. Now, I'll tell you another thing that was a big thing, so, Skip, that I always could hear whispering about it. I could hear my mother and father whispering about this for about 3 or 4 days before New Year's Eve. The whole big bit was to make reservations somewhere. The idea was to make reservations at some big joint someplace where they had a big floor show, or they were giving out souvenirs, or they were giving out horns and paper hats and the whole jazz. And the idea was to get reservations. And the place where they all went, and they whispered around the kids so the kids wouldn't know what was going on. I got the reservations. Yeah, you know, he knows the doorman down there. Okay. And about 10 o'clock at night, they're all getting all dressed up, and there was usually one house where all the kids were put that night. All the kids were put at Aunt Clara's house or something, and one of the poor old aunts would have to stay home. You know, she's pretending like she's enjoying New Year's Eve with the kids, and all the kids are sitting around, half of them are falling asleep, and the radio's going, and they got a couple of paper hats and some horns, and they're going to give them some chocolate cake and some ice cream. They're going to celebrate their New Year's Eve, and they're all they just say, listen, Al, listen, you get the flasks out, Al. Yeah, make sure. Hey, has Fred got the booze? Yeah. And they've got these silver flasks and the booze and all that stuff, and they're and so whatever it was, they were embarked on something that had fantastic sin connected with it. Rottenness, terrible rottenness. Yeah, well, they began to talk about 2 days beforehand about this scene. And of course, the kids, I remember a couple of my cousins, myself, there were always one cousin who knew all about this rottenness, this crummy stuff that they were going to. Well, the place they went to, it's funny now, I don't even know whether there was such a place, but was there ever such a place, do any of you know, such a place in Chicago? It was a big deal, and all the really rotten people went there on New Year's Eve, and the rottener people went there during the week, when it wasn't even New Year's at all. They just went there. It was a real rotten place called the Star and Garter. Well, the Star and Garter was the kind of place that when kids would walk past that joint, they would be embarrassed. They would even have to look the other way to pretend that building didn't even exist there. They'd walk past it. And they had these fantastic posters all over the front of the Star and Garter. In fact, I remember receiving some of my basic sexual education just looking at their signs. They had one chick that was over 74 feet tall. That was a gigantic poster that went up 19 stories all the way up the side. And all she had on was 3 sequins. And she's looking over all of Chicago with these great big blue eyes. And it's the Star and Garter. Wow. And that's where they were going. They'd all go to the Star and Garter. And the kids, you know, the kids, there was such a vague sense of that. What a fantastic thing that must be to go to the show. And then about 4 o'clock in the morning, the kids are already asleep now. You see, I'm lying there, and I still can't sleep, or maybe I'm waking up. And I hear the doors opening. I hear them coming in. You hear this yelling, and here are all these grown-up people. They're yelling and hitting each other, and they're saying, hey, do you remember the one when a guy came out? He came out, he says, hey, Ada! And he had the pig bladder. You remember? He says, hey! And they're telling these awful stories about what these burlesque comics were doing and this stuff. And I'm sitting there, and I'm sweating. I'm lying there under the coats. And then I go, shh, the kids are asleep. Wait, shh, shh, shh. And what about when she came on? Shh, we're crying out while the kids are asleep. I was, shh, shh. They made, you know, the little Judds have big ears. Shh, shh. Well, for years, I had this vague feeling. It was almost a mystical feeling, almost a kind of a religious belief that if you really want to celebrate New Year's Eve, you went to a burlesque house, because that's what these people did, you know. They went to the place called the Star and Garter. Well, and I always had this feeling, because, of course, this was the thing I saw the grown-ups do when I was a little kid, and it seemed to have tremendous glamour to it. And they would all get dressed up, and they'd wear white scarves, you know. The men were my father would have his suit on, all the men would be all with their black shoes, and everything would be shined. The ladies would be in the furs, and they'd smell like the cold, you know, when they'd come in from outside after they were all through with it. They'd smell like that peculiar sweet smell, and you could see where a couple of them had been sick, and it was wild, you know. I had to say, and they'd be covered with old confetti and little strips of colored paper and all that jazz. And I did see this year after year after year after year. They would go to the Star and Garter. They went to a place called the Chez Paris. That was another one. Can you imagine a place with a more completely nightclubby name than the Chez Paris? And they had to spell it that way in Chicago, because everyone would call it the Chez Paris in Chicago. And so they had it spelled Chez Paris. And at the Chez Paris, there was always somebody named Gypsy Rose Lee.
was performing there. Oh, you know, great names. That Candy Bar and Purple Flame were always there. And all these guys, my Uncle Al, my Uncle Carl, my father, they'd say, hey, listen. They're always going down to see somebody. And they actually had big followings in Chicago, these women, these striptease chicks. And they had followings like here in New York City, actors have followings and actresses, you know, like Geraldine Page or Anne Bancroft. There were great battles in the kitchen. I'd hear them yelling and hollering. There would be one crowd of guys, Ada Leonard, Ada Leonard, oh, bang, oh, wow, oh, wow. And there would be an anti-Ada Leonard crowd, and there would be a pro-Ada Leonard crowd. There would be an anti-Gypsy Rose Lee crowd, and there would be a Gypsy, oh, she's 40 feet tall, oh, come on, you can't be serious, what a slob. Back and forth this stuff went. Peaches Browning, oh, she comes out there, what do you mean, that old fat broad? And they yell and holler. Well, that's what passed for dramatic criticism in the house where I grew up at. And they had tremendous arguments. And I'll never forget when television first came in, and on TV was this guy doing this kid show. And he was doing the most innocent kind of kid show. He just didn't want a crummy little kid show. You know, he'd come on every afternoon. He had a tremendous following. What I remember about him is associated with the first night that I ever really did it. I'm going to tell you what happened. I'm in the Army, see? And I go in the Army. I'm just a kid. I'm in the Army now, you see? And this was one of the very first... Oh, this was one of the first New Year's Eves that I really spent where I thought I was an adult. I was a big grown-up man. Big time grown up type guy, and I had a 3-day pass, and there were about nine of us. There was Gasser, there was Zinsmeister, a whole bunch of corporal types, a couple of PFCs, and we're all real tough guys, roughly pushing the cool side of 18. And, you know, we're all walking around drinking a beer down at the PX. Hey, what do you say we're going to take in a Burley Q show on New Year's Eve, huh? Yeah, let's go, gang, let's go. So that's exactly what we did. And we are stationed way out there in the Midwest. In fact, we're in this camp deep in the heart of the Ozarks. And it is New Year's Eve. And we all have a 3-day pass. And so the nearest place, Skip, was Kansas City. I don't know whether you've ever seen Kansas City on a New Year's Eve, but oh, let me tell you. And so all of us get our passion. Oh, boy, we're rubbing our hands again. Here we're 18. Now, my idea of a really big evening up to this point was to go over to Esther Jane Alberry's house and go down to the drugstore and have a Coke, you know, maybe go all the way and have a coffee malt, something like that, and a cheeseburger. And then perhaps we might stop for a couple of minutes and sit there and hold hands on a park bench in the Hessville Park on our way home and make it just in time for the 10 o'clock news back home, you know, that kind of thing. And here I am, I'm 18, a whole bunch of guys of corporals and yardbirds, and I'm out there, and home is a million miles away and a whole scene. And so here we are in Kansas City. We get off the bus, and the place is loaded, millions and millions of soldiers as far as the eye can see, millions of soldiers. And the place is rocking. It is wartime Kansas City. There are defense workers in, and everybody's got money to spend, and the soldiers are out yelling and hollering. The chicks are on the street. And so we arrive down at the Greyhound station, and the three or four of us get out of the bus, and we've got our little bags with us, our DOP kits. Oh, man, New Year's Eve, fire, here we are, swinging. Each one of us had a cool $15 in his pocket, a 3-day pass, and we're ready to go. And so the first thing we do right away, we go to the information place where they have for the soldiers there, USO information. We walk up, and here's this kindly little old lady, you know, with the white hair, you know, the kind that you always see at the information booth for the boys. And we go up and say, hey, you ask her, Carl, go ahead. Carl looked older than anybody else. He said, ask her, Carl. Madam, we're looking for a place to celebrate New Year's. Celebrate New Year's, you know. Oh, yes, of course. Well, down at the YWCA, they're having a cider social, and I'm sure you... you know, somebody nudges, I'll bet cider social, YWCA, wow, oh boy. Yes, and at the YMCA, they're having a donut roast, and I think you'll like this one. Over at the Hotel Claiborne, they're having a special fashion show. a midnight fashion show, and it's free to servicemen. And I have one here. Here's an invitation from the B'nai B'rith. Now, there. Well, thank you very much. Give us the tickets. And so she gave us three or four tickets. We said, oh, boy, let's split. Out we go, and we turn the corner, and there standing in the doorway is this little man with a big gray cap. I say, hey, you guys. Psst, hey. Hey, you guys. He's waiting outside the bus station. Say, hey, you guys. Yeah, for New Year's? I said, yeah. Right away, we could see the real thing. I said, you guys in for New Year's? Yeah. He said, listen, how'd you like to see a show? And there's a moment of silence. Zinsmeister says, show? What kind of show? Don't ask. A show, man. It's New Year's. Yeah. Okay, where? He says, here. He says, I've got... How many guys... By a coincidence, five tickets. Yes, these are the last five. It's only $8.50 each. And so, boom, 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 pow, pow, we're shelling out. We got the pace for it. We are home scot-free. And now all we got to do is wait till midnight. And so we're walking around from one joint to the next, and there's bars, and this place is called the Bamboo Inn, and this place is called the Flamingo Bar, the Bluebird Bar, this place is called Uncle Ned's. I remember all these terrible joints in Kansas City. And you know, Kansas City is probably one of the great swinging towns of all. This is a great gangster town. And you would walk down the street in Kansas City, especially at that time. It's kind of vaguely dark, and all these places are all that. They don't have big lights in the streets like we had, you know, big fluorescent lights. But you see one after the other. There's 18 million bars, millions of them, and all of them. You hear this rotten honky-tonk music coming out. You hear just for miles around. What an exciting place for an ex-kid. Oh, man, bent on a night of debauchery and sin. And we're swinging down the street there. We got our hats on sideways. We have checked our top kids for life. We've got a cool $7 left, each one of us. We each have two water drinks under our belt now. Our eyeballs are spinning. Our teeth are sweating. Our ears are itching. And our knees are loose. We're ready to go. We're in Kansas City. Bum, 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 bada, bum, bum, bum. You don't want to hear the rest of the story, do you? Well, a couple of hours go by and some wild things happen, none of which I will sully your innocent shell-like ears with. What a night. It was just fantastic. I received more education in that one night in Kansas City than all of my years, all of my days combined. Everything conceivable. I can remember running up alleys. I remember sirens. I remember MPs. I can remember guys hollering. I remember people getting hit. I remember somebody throwing a bottle through a window. These are just little brief moments. And all I can remember is say, hey, you guys, I'm reading you. Don't think. Oh, come on. Just crash. And then I remember doing things myself. I remember saying, hey, watch this. Boom. And I'm pushing a jukebox over. I remember doing that. I don't know why I did it. I pushed a jukebox over. And it was one of these big red ones with the juice in it. You know, the juice that goes up and down the side and pour it out. It was, oh, wow. I remember for some reason or other being in a kitchen. Now, I don't quite know how I got in this kitchen, but there were three of us in a kitchen with somebody. And we were slicing lettuce. Now, I don't know why we were doing that. I remember being in a kitchen with lettuce. And the next scene I remember vaguely, not quite clearly, was being in this smelly place where everybody is standing up. And they had taken our tickets away. We are now in the show. And we're all standing up, and there's a stage up there, a little stage with lights, and there is an elderly lady wearing red plumes up there, and she is throwing gold sequins into the audience, and they are playing music, and there is a tenor standing over the side, and he's singing, "Hey, pretty girl, it's like a melody that haunts you night and day." And then she got off the stage, and a guy ran through the audience saying, "All right, I have here a genuine collection of wonderful art poses. These are poses the kind of which all of you men have dreamed about. And I also have here a genuine Mexican wallet containing within its folds, perhaps if you are lucky, a special set of photographs from Gay Paris herself. 25 cents and we have taffy." And I'm standing there, and I remember Zinsmeister being sick on my neck. He was taller than me, and he stood behind me. I went, ah! And then suddenly she goes, and a large lady, a big fat lady wearing purple clothes came on. And the tenor sang, "Hey, pretty girl, is like a melody that haunts you night and day." And then suddenly there is this little short guy wearing a round hat and a checkered suit out there. And he is jumping up and down, and the piano player is playing, and he is telling 30 jokes. He is hollering, "Hey, you guys! And then he squirts water at the audience, and I'm standing there watching, and my stomach is turning over. And the next thing I saw, that little guy, he is doing kid shows on TV. Well, you want to hear the rest of the night? I'll tell you,
these are the times that try men's souls. And they're the times when men's souls are dipped in the crucible of steel that makes them what they are. Oh, you want to hear what happened? Oh, well, I'll tell you what happened finally. It was a very interesting moment. I am down there in this crowd. For those of you who might be contemplating a rash evening tomorrow night, be careful. I am down in this crowd with Zinsmeister, with Gasser, with about four other GIs, Rosenblatt, and a whole bunch of the guys from the company, Company K. We're down there yelling and hollering. We're screaming and having a great time. Zinsmeister has been sick twice now down my neck, and they're selling the candy kisses. The guys are buying all the pictures. I think some of them still have the pic. They're autograph pictures, by the way. When all of a sudden, the lights went up, and the entire crowd were marched into a paddy wagon, including me. I'm going to tell you this. If you can find somewhere that blotter in Kansas City, you will find the name of Corporal J.P. Shepherd, 1609-8946, Company K, 817th Signal Training Battalion, Camp Crown. The whole crowd of us were in there and booked for observing a licentious and lewd performance. And I remember sitting in there with a whole bunch of guys in the bullpen, guys being drunk, and they kept bringing chorus girls in, the cops kept bringing jazz musicians in, who were trying to blow their nose with their ear, they kept bringing this whole party, and the next morning they let all the GIs loose, and that night I'm at the USO, it is Sunday, and I'm trying to write my mother about what I did here. Festival, and I had a very good time. Carl Sinspicer says hello. He had a big shiner sitting next to me. Happy New Year again.
That was the Gene Shepherd Show, War AM, with the original transmission date, December 30, 1964, entitled as the New Year's Eve Raid at the Kansas City Burlesque House. Here is the Harold Perry Show entitled New Year's Dance, is broadcasted on December 27, 1950.
The Harold Perry Show. And now, Harold Perry as Honest Harold the Homemaker. Well, let's look in on the little town of Melrose Springs this crisp December evening. Honest Harold, like the rest of us, is in that pleasantly dazed holiday condition. He is just recovering from Christmas in time to build up his strength for New Year's. Right now, he's bidding goodnight to his new romance, the lovely Theodora.
Oh, this has been a wonderful week, Haroldy Waroldy.
Sure has, Theodora. I've seen you every night.
I just love the holiday season, don't you?
Yeah. I'll never forget Christmas Eve when I gave you that wristwatch. You threw yourself in my arms and kissed me. Remember?
Do I?
Let's try that again, shall we?
But, Harold, how could we ever recapture that special moment? Christmas, the wristwatch.
Well, you sing Jingle Bells and I'll start ticking. Yeah.
Oh, Harold.
Oh, well, I guess I can wait. Tomorrow night's New Year's Eve. And you know what happens at 12 o'clock? All lang syne is kissing time.
Harold.
Yeah?
You haven't told me where we're going New Year's Eve.
I want to wait and surprise you. I won't tell you till tomorrow.
All right, teddy bear.
Theodora.
Yes.
How about a little kiss?
Now, Harold, you'll have to wait till New Year's Eve.
Oh. Isn't it strange, Theodora? New Year's Eve comes at different times all over the world. Why, right now, probably, it's New Year's Eve in Honolulu.
It is?
Yeah. Pucker up, Theodora.
Harold.
Yakahula hickey doola. Doola.
Harold, you're not eating your breakfast.
Huh? Well, Mother, I was just thinking about New Year's Eve party tonight and what a good time Theodora and I are going to have.
Oh, I think it's nice the way you and your old friends get together and have a party every New Year's Eve.
Yeah, they can have their big city swanky affairs. I bet we have a lot more fun right here in Melrose Springs at our New Year's barn dance.
Yes, we love the dear hearts and gentle people that live in our hometown.
That's right, Mother. We may have cider instead of champagne and play corny games like pin the tail on the donkey, but it's fun.
Oh, yes. Remember last year's party when Dr. Yancey was trying to pin the tail on the donkey and he jabbed the pin in one of the guests?
Yeah, that was me. That's when I was bobbing for apples, Mother.
I suppose Theodora thinks a barn dance is quite a novelty.
Well, I haven't told her yet. I thought I'd surprise her.
Oh, Harold, don't you think you should tell her? She might expect something fancier. You know, she's from Kansas City.
Yeah. No, she'll love it, Mother.
Well, I think
I told Doc and Pete I'd help them decorate the barn this morning. I better get over there.
But you ought to drop by Theodora's and let her know what she's supposed to wear tonight.
Wear? Oh, I'll see you later, Mother. I'll tell her to wear a gingham dress. She'll look like Daisy May. And I'll be your little Abner.
Shall I pass the Kickapoo Joy Juice, son?
What? Mother! Oh, brother, see you later. Yeah, Doc and Pete should be out here in the barn. Hello, Doc, old friend.
Oh, hello, Harold.
Where's Pete?
Oh, he's downtown getting the bunting.
The bunting? Oh, say, the barn's starting to look fine, Doc. You must have done a lot of work this morning.
Oh, not so much. All I did was tack up the streamers, make the sign.
Okay, Doc.
Mix the potato salad by the cider.
Yeah, that's great.
Slice the hot dog rolls, tune the musical chairs.
Yes. Well, I bet we're going to have a lot of fun tonight. And Theodora's just going to love it. Apple bobbing, square dancing, sack racing. Mm. Just think, maybe the two of us will be in the same sack.
Well, I didn't know you cared, Harold.
Not you, Doc. Theodora.
Oh! Oh.
Well, happy 1951, boy.
Well, hello, Pete, old pal. Did you bring the bunting?
Bunting? Oh, Shaw, I knew I forgot something.
Oh, Pete!
Well, I've been busy, boy. Don't forget, I'm chairman of the door prize committee.
Did you get some good prizes, Pete?
I sure did. I got the Elks to donate the grand prize.
Oh?
A free, all-expense-paid 90-day vacation to Charleville.
Yeah. A 90-day vacation? Won't that cost them a lot of money?
No, it's just a round-trip bus ticket. You can return any time within 90 days.
Very funny, Pete. We've got to get this barn decorated. Why don't you run down now and get that bunting? Huh?
All right. Oh, Harold, before I go, maybe you'd like to hear Doc and me rehearse.
Rehearse?
Oh, I forgot to tell you, Harold. Pete and I are going to perform a little New Year's pageant at the party tonight.
A pageant?
Yes. I'm going to be Father Time, and Pete'll be the Baby New Year.
Oh, my goodness, Baby New Year.
Yeah. I come out dressed in a ribbon.
Look, fellas, how about decorating the barn?
At the stroke of midnight, I come out as Father Time. It's a real character part. Uh-huh. And I say, well, another 365 days have gone by. That makes another year.
No kidding.
So ring out the old and ring in the new. Ring in the new. Okay, Pete.
Oh.
Oh, what was that?
Aha! 'Tis Baby New Year.
Sounds like the noon whistle at the mattress factory.
Fellas, how about...
Greetings, everyone. I am Baby New Year.
Ooh.
I was just born. Goo, goo, goo.
Goodbye. I'll see you, fellas, later. That Pete.
I am Baby New Year.
Horrible actors, but nice fellas, though. Yeah, we're gonna have a swell time tonight.
Station Cash, JP. Just a moment, I'll connect you.
Oh, good morning, Glory.
Oh, good morning, Harold.
Is our dear boss Stanley Peabody in?
Yes, he is.
Hmm. Thought maybe I'd ask him to our barn dance tonight. He's an old prissy pants, but what the heck. It's New Year's.
Because Raymond and I are going to a party tonight at my girlfriend's.
Oh, that's nice.
Oh, she goes with a fella in the Navy. He's a chief petting officer.
Yeah. Lori, you got that wrong. He's not a petting officer.
Well, according to my girlfriend, he is.
Oh, good.
And Harold, if you want to, you can use that joke on your radio program. There's no charge.
There's no joke either. See you later, Gloria. Everybody's a comic around here. See if Stanley wants to go to the party.
Come in. Oh, hello, Hemp.
Well, Happy New Year, Stanley, old friend.
Thank you. Hempy New Year to you.
Yeah.
Get it? Hey. Why don't we have a drink to that?
A drink? Well,
yes. Let me pour you a glass of yogurt.
Yeah. No, thanks, Stanley. I'll skip this round. Stanley, we're having our big New Year's party in Doc Yancey's barn tonight. Thought you might like to join us.
In Doc Yancey's barn?
Yeah.
Thank you, Hemp. But I've already made my plans for tonight.
Oh?
I'm going to the formal dance at the Antler Hotel in the Moose Room.
Yeah.
Everyone will be wearing tails.
In the Moose Room, I guess I'll.
Yes, it'll be quite swanky.
Yeah?
I'm taking Miss Abigail Turner. She's one of the Turners, you know.
Mm.
Her family came here over 100 years ago.
Yeah, she looks it. Well, sorry you can't make it, Stanley. I know Theodora and I'll have a wonderful time.
You mean Theodora consented to go to this barn dance?
Well, I haven't told her yet, but I know she'll love it.
Oh, Hemp, you fool you.
Huh?
Theodore's a sophisticated girl. To her, New Year's Eve means formal dress, dinner, imported champagne.
Well, our cider's imported from Charleville.
Taking Theodora to that hayseed affair.
What?
How can you be such a hick?
I hate him.
Cider imported from Charleville. Ah, you kill me.
I better get out of here before I take him up on that. Peabody can't scare me. I'll bet Theodore will love that barn dance. What if it is corny? I'm a little corny myself. That's the kind of a girl I want. One I can settle down with and raise little corn muffins. She's from a big town, though. Kansas City. They have storm drains there. Well, I'll kind of fish around and find out. Hope she's in. It's Harold.
Have a chair. I'll be right there.
What am I worried about? She's corny, all right.
Hello, curly lashes.
Curly lashes. Hello, Theo.
Oh, I bet you came over to tell me where you're taking me tonight.
Well, you see...
Come on out. Tell Theodora.
Theodora, how about playing a little game first?
We played spin the bottle the last time you were here.
Yeah. That's when I brought the loaded bottle. So this is a word game and called association, Theodora. You find out what the other person is thinking.
Oh.
I mention a word to you and you say whatever it makes you think of. Are you ready?
Well, all righty.
Good. New Year's Eve.
Pheasant under glass.
Oop. You're having hot dogs under relish. Let's try it again, huh? New Year's Eve.
Champagne in a bucket.
We're having 7-Up in a tub. Try it once more. New Year's Eve.
Swanky supper club.
Oop.
White tie and tails.
Zeef. Maybe I can trap her. Barn dance.
Tennessee Ernie.
Zoink.
Now, Harold, tell me, where are you taking me tonight?
Antler room. I mean, Antler Hotel. Moose room. I'll be the third moose from the right.
We'll return for the second act of our story, Honest Harold, in just a moment. Have you seen who's joining Bing Crosby on his show tonight? It's Dinah Shore, Louis Armstrong, and Jack Teagarden. That's just a little later this evening over most of these same CBS stations. The Bing Crosby Show. And now, back to Honest Harold, the Homemaker. Well, it looks as though Honest Harold's Happy New Year isn't going to be so happy. For the first time, he isn't going to see the new year in with his old friends. Instead, he has talked himself into stepping out at the Antler Hotel to make an impression on the lovely Theodora. It's afternoon now, and we find Harold dejectedly returning home.
How am I going to tell Doc and Pete I'm not coming to the barn dance tonight? Fine friend I turned out to be. I'm a cad. Deserting him on New Year's Eve. Running around in moose tails.
Is that you, Harold?
I don't know, Mother.
Well, did you see Theodora?
Yeah, I did.
Is she happy about where you're taking her tonight?
Oh, yeah, she's very happy.
Oh, you two will have a wonderful time. And maybe Theodora will pin the tail on the donkey.
She did.
Oh, Harold. You just got a phone call from Dr. Yancey.
From Doc?
Yes, he thought your feelings might be hurt because you're not in the pageant tonight. Wasn't that sweet of him? I can just see the three of you at your New Year's party tonight, your arms around each other singing, should old acquaintance be forgotten?
Mother!
And never brought to mind!
Mother, please, you're flat.
Shut up!
Oh, Mother! Guess I better drop in and tell Pete I can't come tonight. Might as well get it over with. He'll understand, I think. Hello, Pete.
Howdy, boy.
Pete,
Harold, if you want to take my part in the pageant tonight, it's okie-dokie with me, old friend. Here's my ribbon.
Oop. Well, thanks, Pete, but...
You'd make an awful cute baby New Year. It's an easy part to learn, boy. Four lines and three goos.
Well, that's nice of you, Goo, Pete. But you see, I can't come tonight. I'm going to the formal dance at the Antler Hotel.
What? Oh, sure. You're going to the Antler Hotel, and I'm Margaret Truman.
Margaret, Pete, I...
You'd like to hear me sing a cadenzi, boy?
Pete, you don't understand.
You're going to the Antler Hotel tonight. Ain't that a doozy?
Pete, this is no doozy. I'm really going there tonight. I'm taking Theodora.
Oh.
Pete, I'm really awfully sorry. I just couldn't help it.
Sure, boy.
You know I really want to be with you, Foz.
Sure, boy. Harold, it's a good thing I ain't Margaret Truman. I'd tell my father on you.
I guess Doc's in the barn here. Certainly hate to tell him about tonight. Well, I gotta do it. Oh, there he is. Oh, my goodness, he's got his pet goat with him. Wonder if Pete's told him I'm not coming. Hello, Doc.
Good afternoon, Mr. Hemp.
Oop, Pete told him, all right. Doc, I'd like to explain.
How does this bunting look up here?
Oh, looks swell, Doc.
I was speaking to Arthur, my goat.
Oh, excuse me.
Arthur. What would you think of a man who deserted his old friends on New Year's Eve?
Yeah, you sure bleated a bib full, Arthur.
Doc, will you listen to me?
If you don't mind, I'm very busy right now. Arthur, do you like the way I've hung the bunting? Well, that's very sweet of you, thank you.
Doc, I want to come.
Arthur, I bet you wouldn't desert your fellow goats and try to horn into high society.
Horn in? Now, wait a minute.
No, sir, you wouldn't be off somewhere dining on caviar. You'd be right here with your old friends munching tin cans.
Doc, I'd munch tin cans. I mean, I'd like to be here with you fellas tonight. You know that, don't you? Doc, old friend, don't you believe me? Say something. Not you, Arthur.
That was me, Harold.
And that was me. Goodbye.
Are you having a good time, Harold?
Oh, sure. Moose Room is very nice. Wonder what the fellows are doing at the barn dance.
You waltz beautifully.
Yeah.
Thank you, Theodora. It's a good thing. Guess it's all that orchestra knows. They played 3 o'clock in the morning 3 times. It's only 9:15. What a finish. Well, should we go back to our table?
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sort of a quiet crowd for New Year's Eve, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Look at that fellow in the corner there with a big chin. He has mooed for an hour.
Harold, that's a stuffed moose.
I thought he was sitting kind of high.
Harold, are you sure you're having a good time?
Good time? Oh, sure. I'm having... Oh, my goodness.
What's the matter?
Stanley Peabody coming with his girl. I don't want to get stuck with Prissy Pants. I'll duck down so he won't see me.
Oh, Harold.
Oh, hello, Theodora. Hemp, oop. What are you doing under the table?
Under the table? I was looking for the thing.
Oh, how amusing!
Looks like Stanley brought the thing with him.
May I present Miss Abigail Turner, Miss Theodora, and Mr. Harold Hemp.
How do you do?
How do you do?
Oh, I have a wonderful idea. Why don't Abigail and I sit at your table?
Well,
yes, you sit here, Abby Dabby.
Abby Dabby sounds like a candy bar.
Thank you.
And I'll sit here. Just think, the four of us will spend the whole evening together.
Yeah, I am thinking.
Well, shall we get into the festive mood? I think I'll blow my horn. Whoopee! Come on, Theodora. Hemp, laugh and be gay.
Oh, brother.
Are you feeling merry, Abigail?
Oh, yes, I feel so New Year's easy. I feel like singing that new popular song.
Oh?
Oh, the music goes round and round. Oh, how, 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 how.
Oh.
You know, Abigail is a debutante. Came out in 39.
Yeah, probably hasn't been out since.
Harold.
What is it?
Don't look so glum. Say something to our guest.
Oh, yeah. Having a good time, Abigail? I said, are you having a good time, Abigail?
The music goes round and round. Oh, how, 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 how.
Whoopee! Oh, I feel so exhilarated. Abby.
Yes, Stanley.
Why don't you tell that uproarious riddle? Oh, Hemp, this will send you right out of the room.
Yeah, I hope so.
Go on, Abby Dabby.
Well, I asked the question. How do you get down from an elephant?
I don't know, Abigail. How do you get down from an elephant?
You don't get down from an elephant. You get down from a duck. The music goes round and round.
Whoopee!
Stanley, not in my face.
Oh, 3 o'clock in the morning. I love that piece.
Yeah, the orchestra must love it, too. Well, Theodora, should we dance?
Hemp, suppose I have this dance with Theodora and you and Abigail can get better acquainted.
But...
Come on, Theodora.
Well, all right.
But...
Excuse us, please. Theodora, do you like to twirl?
Oh, Mr. Hemp, isn't it fun?
Yeah, the music goes round and round.
almost midnight. Shall we unfold our paper hats?
I ate mine. It was better than the chicken. Did you say it was almost midnight?
Almost.
Wonder what the fellows are doing at the barn dance.
Oh, the orchestra is getting ready to play, Stan.
Oh, good.
Oh, goodness.
Abigail, shall we dance this one?
Oh, I'd love to.
Excuse us, please.
Certainly.
Harold.
Yes, Theodora?
You don't seem very happy tonight.
Happy? Oh, sure, I'm very happy. Music goes round and round.
Oh, Harold, will you excuse me for a moment? I want to speak to a friend over there.
Of course. Go right ahead, Theodora.
I'll be right back.
Gee, what a clam bake. What a way to spend New Year's Eve. With Stanley Peabody instead of my old friends. Should have told Theodora about the barn dance. Let's face it, honest Harold, you're a weakling. Well, they do know another song. Why does it have to be that one? Gee, what I'd give the world to see that old gang of mine. I can't forget that old quartet that sang Sweet Adeline. Goodbye forever, old fellows and gals. Goodbye forever, old sweethearts and pals. God bless 'em. Gee, but I'd give the world to see that old gang of mine. Yeah, that's where I ought to be, with my old gang, with Pete and Doc and Arthur the goat. And that's where I'm going, right now.
Why, Harold, what's the matter?
Theodora, I'm sorry, but I'm going.
Going where?
To the barn dance. Should have gone there in the first place. But I knew you wouldn't want to go to a corny party like that.
Oh, Harold, why didn't you ask me?
Huh?
I wondered why you wanted to come here instead of spending New Year's with your friends.
You did?
And I'd love to go to your barn dance.
You would? Well.
Oh, Hemp.
Oh, Stanley.
Whoopee! New Year's comes but once a year.
You said it, and we're not going to spend it here. Come on, Theodora. Hope we're in time, Theodora. Must be almost 12 o'clock.
Yes.
Here's the barn. Sounds kind of quiet in there. Oh, they're doing the pageant. Come on.
Ah, what was that? It's Baby New Year.
Yeah, good old Doc.
It's Baby New Year. Pete.
Oh, yeah.
Look at Pete in that ribbon.
Isn't that cute?
I am Baby New Year. Go, go, achoo!
You know he fits full in that costume.
I was, yeah.
Hi, Harold.
Hi, Pete, old friend.
My hair.
Hello, Doc.
Oh, I'm glad to see you. Why, it wouldn't have been New Year's without you, would it, Pete?
It sure wouldn't, boy.
Thanks, I really missed you, fellas. Say.
Oh, it's 12 o'clock, everybody.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, Harold.
Happy New Year, boy.
Happy New Year, fellas. Happy New Year, Theodora. Oop. Happy New Year to you, Arthur, but I'm not going to kiss you.
Well, it's time for Auld Lang Syne.
Okay, come on, fellas. You take the tenor part, Arthur.
Should old acquaintance be forgot and never brought to mind? Should old acquaintance be forgot and
I know that all of you listening in tonight are anxious to hear about our Operation Santa Claus venture to Travis Air Force Base and what happened to the thousands of gifts you sent in.
I have a wire from Colonel Kelly, commanding officer, that I'd like to read to you. Quote, your recent gratifying personal appearance at Travis Air Force Base will long be remembered by all who saw you. Your bright laughter and good cheer to the men who needed it most, wounded Korean veterans in the base hospital, and combat-ready servicemen bound overseas. Your huge store of gaily wrapped gifts, which you personally distributed to the war wounded and the outbound troops, was especially appreciated and will not soon be forgotten. As commanding officer, I wish to take this opportunity of expressing through you my heartfelt gratitude to all the kindly people, your radio listeners, who made those thousands of gifts possible. Again, thanks to you and your troop, Harold Perry, for an appearance that brought the true spirit of Christmas to Travis Air Force Base. Joe W. Kelly, Colonel, United States Air Force Commanding. Unquote. I wish it were possible to thank all you personally for your gifts to the boys. Being able to make them a bit happier on Christmas was the most wonderful experience of my life. Thanks again from the bottom of my heart, and a Happy New Year to you all.
You have just heard the Harold Perry Show, Honest Harold. The supporting players tonight included Mari Alden, Jane Morgan, Parley Bear, Olin Soule, and Mary Jane Croft, and featured Gloria Holliday as Gloria and Joseph Kearns as Old Doc Yak Yak. Norman MacDonald directed, and the music was composed and conducted by Jack Meekin.
Pretty too, wasn't it?
Honest Harold, created by Harold Perry, was written by Gene Stone, Jack Robinson, and Dick Powell.
Good writers.
Yes, and remember, the Rose Bowl game between Michigan and California will be broadcast next Monday, New Year's Day, exclusively over most of these same CBS stations. Stay tuned now for the Bing Crosby Show, which follows immediately on most of these same CBS stations. This is Roy Rowan speaking. This is CBS, where you thrill to suspense on Thursday night, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
That was the Harold Perry Show entitled, New Year's Dance, as broadcasted on December 27, 1950. That's it for this episode of Airchecks. We have a two-hour special for the episode that will be released directly after this one, which will be the Joy Boys New Year's Eve Party as broadcasted on January 1, 1961 on WRC in Washington, D.C. The Joy Boys were Ed Walker and Willard Scott, of the first Ronald McDonald and the weather forecaster from the NBC's Today Show. Stay tuned for that. Starting on January 6, we will be switching to 1 3-hour podcast and upload it every Saturday. You will be able to hear us on the KTI Radio Network every Sunday at noon. This is because I will be busy with other projects for the next year or so. See you on the same time and same channel.